Welcome, everyone, friends, alumni, colleagues, stargazers, to this very special event on this very beautiful fall afternoon. On a Wednesday, I'm always happy to leave my office to come here. And it's funny because, you know, we were all eager to go back to the offices with the pandemic. And now that we've been in the offices for a few weeks, I'm starting to remember why it was that I wanted to get out of the office. And you know, and this is and there's really no better excuse and no more fun excuse than doing these events. My name is Fernando Miralles-Wilhelm. I have the privilege to serve as George Mason University's Dean for the College of Science. And it's really my honor to welcome you all here. For those of you that have attended our Mason Science Series in the past, you know, we're experimenting with a little bit of a different format, doing it here at the Country Club. I'm told that we used to do boring PowerPoint presentations and Excel spreadsheets and things of that nature. We're not under my leadership. We're not doing those again. You know, this is one of my favorite parts of being dean is having the opportunity to meet colleagues from different disciplines that bring a different perspective, and certainly our guest today does that in spades. You know, we are gonna be welcoming Dr. Hakeem Oluseyi, and please, if I'm not doing justice to the pronunciation, please excuse me. Hakeem is a renowned astrophysicist, cosmologist, inventor, educator, TV personality, and great public speaker. I think the first time I heard about Hakeem, I had just joined Mason, and remember we had a little bit of a Zoom call, and the Zoom call was, you know, this is someone you should meet and let's talk. And so after spending about 45 minutes with Hakeem, I really spent like 3 hours on YouTube and looking at videos and looking up and reading about him. It was a fascinating conversation. So Hakeem's been engaged with Mason as an affiliated faculty for some time now, but recently he got appointed to a very special position as Robinson Professor at Mason. And these are faculty that we bring into Mason that from the outside who have professional, scientific, personal perspectives that can bring that to the classroom. And he's gonna be working with Mason on a number of things, you know, helping teach classes, looking at curricula, spearheading some research, allowing us to explore new ways to communicate our science. So we're really looking forward to that. He actually just published a book with some of his memoirs. He's still a very young individual, so you'll have many more memoirs to come, right? So you'll probably end up writing 2 or 3 books like this. But
it's a hair dye illusion.
Yeah, yeah. In the book, he talks about his roots, which are in some of the toughest neighborhoods around the country, including Houston's 3rd Ward, New Orleans' 9th Ward, rural Mississippi, South Central Los Angeles. Some of his relatives were part of this notorious Crips gang, and he talks about how at 9 years old he was drawn into criminal activity. He eventually overcame the pull of that life and graduated from Stanford University with a PhD in physics. And just a very few list of his professional accolades. He served as Distinguished Professor of Aerospace Physics and Space Sciences at Florida Tech. He has held professorship appointments at MIT, University of California at Berkeley, University of Washington, and the University of Cape Town. He has also served as a Space Science Education Manager of the Science Mission Directorate at NASA, headquarters here in Washington, D.C. He has been Chief Science Officer of Discovery Science and President of the National Society of Black Physicists. If you do what I did and look him up on the web, you're gonna find that he has appeared in programming from Netflix to Discovery Science to National Geographic, PBS, BBC, and many, many more. We're very pleased that you've been appointed as a Robinson Professor. This really recognizes outstanding faculty that are out there that can come to campus and really enrich our experience. So please, everyone, join me in welcoming Hakeem.
Thank you. Thank you.
I was telling you earlier that, you know, we've met a few times, and you wouldn't tell by meeting and looking at you having that background. So as I read more about you and as I learned and I start reading your book, I'm saying, wow, talk about having it hard and overcoming, you know, and all these things. Let's start with your childhood, you know, share a little bit there, because, you know, we're parents, we have kids, you know, it would be good to hear a little bit of that reflection from your early days.
Absolutely. You know, you're absolutely right. You know, if it were not for education, you know, for me, education is a pathway, clearly. So I feel like I have to do for others what was done for me. I say, you know, I got by on hope, hustle, and help, right? And so, you know, that help just showed up out of the blue. So I have to do the same thing. And so as I looked around, I left academia at the end of December 2014, and I went to MIT for a year and a half. I ended up coming here to NASA headquarters, but I absolutely missed academia. I miss working with students. I miss research. I miss impacting lives in that way. Now, as I looked around at the universities around the area, I don't know how many are there here in the DMV, like 300. You know, I wanted to find a student population that I didn't have to drive an hour or two to interact with, where I could make a difference. You know, people from working class communities. You know, there's a lot of, where I was at Florida Tech, most of those students would have been okay whether I was there or not, right? but there are people for whom someone like myself can make that difference in their life, right? And so that's why I wanted to be associated with Mason. But my childhood. So everybody starts from their parents. So as far as education goes, there was no history of educational attainment in my family. I'm the first high school graduate. My father dropped out of school when he was 9 years old. My mother dropped out of school when she was 16 and pregnant with my older sister. Coincidentally, her mother dropped out of school when she was pregnant and 16, and my sister also dropped out of school when she was pregnant and 16. So my parents divorced when I was 4 years old. And my mother, so I had this, I gotta tell you a story. I like to tell jokes, so you better laugh. I had this, when I graduated physics from Tougaloo College in 1991, I was one of two physics graduates. The other guy, his name was Lorenzen Dunbar. He's since passed away. He was very tall, like 6'5". He was very thin and wore his hair like Bart Simpson in a high top fade. But this guy was super charismatic, super outgoing. He used to tell me what to do, keep me on track. But I say this to tell you something about my childhood. But Lorenzen had an unusual name, right? Lorenzen. And so often when he would meet someone new, they'd say, wow, such a beautiful name. Does it mean anything? And he would always reply, yeah, me and my mama black. So it's a thing, right? And so I say that to bring up my mama, because, you know, I moved every year. Once my parents divorced, I never went to the same school or lived in the same state 2 years in a row. And oftentimes I moved every, you know, multiple times during the year. So people would always ask, oh, were your parents in the military? And like Lorenzen, my answer is no, my mama was tripping. So, but you know, she was a struggling single mother and she was seeking out various opportunities. And we found ourselves, you know, moving between South Central Los Angeles, Houston's Third Ward and South Park area, New Orleans East, New Orleans Ninth Ward, rural Mississippi. And of course, what these communities have in common is you might get shot, right? That was a joke. Don't make me rob y'all. Okay, so he's like, dude. So welcome. Welcome, Dr. Oluseyi. So what happens is my cousins were members of the Crips gang, like you mentioned, and those guys in the 80s started robbing banks and worse. And they went to prison for a couple dozen years and they got out in the early 2000s. And my one cousin, Ralph, just like me, if you met him today, you'd never know, right? But then my other cousin, Chris, he maintained a drug habit while in prison. So when he got out, he started robbing banks again and he went back immediately, and that's where he is today, right? And so at the end of this period of me moving, this decade of moving, the last 16 months of that, I lived in 9 different households and attended 5 different schools in 3 different states, right? My mother would leave me with families, friends of the family, family of the family, and for some reason, the man in the house always abused me. Most of the time, it was physical violence. There was this one guy, James Davis, because I joke a lot, he labeled me a fool. So he'd wake me up at like 2-3 in the morning, I'm 11, and made me read Bible verses about being a fool, right? And so, at the end of this time period, you know, I'm going through puberty. And by the way, my father is an interesting story because he left home at 13, went to New Orleans, got a job parking cars for 25 cents a day. When he turned 17, he signed up for the Army and went away to the Korean War. Now, my father's family were bootleggers. You guys know what that means? Yeah, in rural Mississippi, farming, hunting, fishing, and bootlegging. So when my dad, got back from the Korean War, he decided to take the business to the next level. And my father passed away at the end of 2010, but I think if he were alive today, he would be tickled pink that his business is now legal in many Western states.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's legal in Virginia, but so my dad incorporated me into his business immediately upon being reunited when I was 8 years old. And that means I was involved in the packaging, the processing, and when the adults were away from home, I manned the store alone as a 9-year-old. Now, simultaneously, right, so, you know, I called my family life crime school, right? That's what I was experiencing. But at the same time, I was a nerd, right? I because I had suffered so much, like I didn't have a language for this until very recently, but because I had suffered so much trauma, in fact, I was gonna, when I started writing the book, I had many fewer chapters, and the chapters had titles. And the first chapter was titled, Meet the Humans, It Ain't Safe, right? And that's how I felt, and in some ways still feel that way. And so whereas, most humans bond with other humans, I bonded with books. And so I was talking to my brother, my younger brother, last week, and he was reminding me, he was like, yeah, man, no matter what was going on, you were always there in a corner with a book, carrying a book around everywhere, looking at a book. And people found that incredibly unusual. A lot of people have the expectation that in the hood, people are gonna hate you for that, right? And in the cities, I did get some of that, but when I got to rural Mississippi, they celebrated it, right? Whatever you were good at, people supported you. If you were a good dancer, singer, preacher, whatever, right? People supported you. And so the example that I always give people for them to understand is the show Amateur Night at the Apollo. You guys, anybody remember that show?
Yes, yes.
And so at the end of the amateur night, they'd have the kids come out, and Kiki Shepherd would ask them, what is your favorite subject in school? And if a kid said math or science, the audience would lose their mind, right? And that's because even though it's not that common in our community, we recognize how valuable people are that get involved in that. So everybody wants to encourage that, right? And so I did receive that encouragement. So when I finally settled in rural Mississippi at the age of 13, even though I was undereducated from that point forward, I was the safest I had ever been in my life. And I received positive feedback rather than constantly, being the bad guy. At least I stood a chance of not being the bad guy there.
Yeah, no, I have to. I would have assumed that in South Central LA, that would have not happened.
Probably not, yeah, man. Probably not. And the other thing is that what I meant to also know is that how that shaped me, right? So it wasn't just my experiences. There's also the messaging that you receive of who you are and what you're supposed to do in life. And then there's also the fact that, humans are made to survive, just like every other animal. And so you adapt things that are not necessarily your personality, but this is what I need to do to survive. And so I figured out, it's much better for me to punch you in the face first. It's much better for me to intimidate you before you intimidate me, right? And so for half my life, I wore this suit of armor, and so it wasn't until I was almost 30, as I describe in this book, I had to cut the character out But I had this, these two good friends. One, she's now Dr. Melinda Kelly Johnson. This guy, Marcus Howard. And Melinda, she was a psychology undergraduate. We became best friends when I was a graduate student. And she's the person that taught me that I'm worthy of love and respect simply because I exist. And I feel like that's what led to me being an overachiever in some ways, you know, proving myself constantly. And then my friend Marcus Howard, you know, who taught me that, dude, it's okay to be a nice guy. You know, you're intrinsically a nice guy. Take off the suit of armor, you know, and be you. And it's okay. The humans aren't as scary as you think they are. Of course, you really are, but I know how to handle you. So.
No, interesting. So I can see how those early years reading books sort of seeded in you, you know, or set you in that path that take you to where you are today. But I'm also curious whether the other part of your childhood,
yeah,
are there traits, qualities from, you know, manning your dad's store or hanging out with your cousins, are any of those things, are they useful to you today? Or have they been useful to you in your career? I'm curious about that.
Well, you know, there's another, well, hustle. Like hustle, make it happen, right? That's important. But also, you know, the other thing that I experienced is growing up in rural America, you know, when I moved to Mississippi, you know, kids started working at like 7, 8 years old, right? And so, you know, I had to go haul pulpwood. Does anybody know what hauling pulpwood is? Right, yeah. Exactly. It is the worst, difficult, toughest work. You know, I started at 12 years old. I wasn't the youngest guy out there, right? There was an 8-year-old out there. And so even though I was incredibly undereducated, I had the idea always, I can outwork everybody on this planet, right? I know how to ignore all my pain, everything my body is telling me, and just push forward, right? And it wasn't until even later in life that I realized, you know, there's so much, you know, when you grow up, you know, you don't go to the doctor, you don't buy expensive anything. And so you're in a state of discomfort, like all the time, right? Your clothing hurts, you know, but then, you know, later in life you learn like, oh man, I didn't realize that, you know, but that to some degree that learning to ignore my pain and push forward. Like I'll give you another example. I got out of the Navy in 1986. That very first week I went to play basketball, I thought I had dislocated my shoulder. I had broken my shoulder. And of course I didn't go to the doctor, because you don't go to the doctor. So it's not until I'm in graduate school when I realize after being there a year, you know, in graduate school you have to have medical insurance. And it became, oh, I have medical insurance, which means I can go to the doctor? So I decide to go to the doctor about my shoulder. I walk into the orthopedic surgeon's office and he goes, right shoulder? And I'm like, you're a genius, how did you know? And he's like, are you serious? And I'm like, yeah, and he takes me to a mirror and I didn't notice what my shoulder was like down here, right? And I had to have a full reconstruction of my shoulder. I don't remember what question you asked me, but.
No, I think you've given us some lights into that.
Certainly
the hard work ethic and
So I tell you, I like to tell these stories because it's one of these things that if you don't know, you don't know, right? And it's able to give people insights into how you think, what you're going through, how you make decisions, because people might think that, oh, just say no and things like that, which are ridiculous, right? It makes, in real time, it makes sense what you're doing, right? You're doing what makes sense to you at that time. You're not thinking like, I'll destroy my life now, right? Nobody approaches things that way, you know?
Talk to me a little bit about, your educational experience now. How do you go from rural Mississippi to Stanford? Can you fill us in there? I mean, I'm sure there's plenty there. Yeah.
So what happened was when I was in that 11 years old, moving from state to state. So what had happened just before that is I had discovered books, right? I discovered adult books at the age of 9. I talk about when I read Roots for the first time. So the next year when I'm 10 years old, I decide that I'm gonna read our World Book Encyclopedias from A to Z, right? You know, I was left alone a lot, right? And so I get to E and I encounter Albert Einstein in relativity, right? So I was always, you know, really excited about the natural world, and I was always really into weird stuff, you know, Loch Ness Monster, Bigfoot, you know? And so, physics is where they meet, right? Weird stuff in the natural world. So I decided at that point that I'm going to teach myself relativity. But I also was just devouring books. So the next year, I get tested, you know, I was in California, and I get tested, get an IQ test, and I get put in this program called the Mentally Gifted Minors Program, MGM. And that's when, you know, teachers start to reach out. But of course, this is the year where I'm moving every time. So I get tested, you're mentally gifted, you go to a special program, oops, time to move to Houston, right? I go there, and it's like, oh yeah, we're gonna put you in the math club and this other competition, oh, time to move back to LA, you know, and it was, you know, so I never really caught traction. So I have a co-writer, Josh Horowitz. So when we started writing the book, the idea is that it would be a standard ghostwriter type situation. It didn't end up being that way. But what's interesting about that is that for like several months, we just talked and told each other stories. And you know, his father was a neuroscientist, a neurologist, and you know, he's a Jewish guy, grew up, you know, well-to-do family. And he would say to me things like, so when you were tested, how come they didn't, you know, put you in a, you know, how come your family didn't move to put you in a good school? I'm like, are you serious? No one would have done that. He interviewed my sister and he goes, did you tell your mother that you didn't like moving? Now, he didn't tell me that story, she told me that story, right? And when she said that sentence, you know what we both did? Bust out laughing. No explanation necessary, right? It's like, of course I didn't tell my mother that. I enjoy having teeth, right? You know, it's like, and what's the point anyway, right? You know, and so just the way life happens in different communities, different households was so startling to each other as we were, you know, telling each other these stories.
I'm curious, so you mentioned the help part in your, and I have to assume that role models, mentors were along the way. So tell us a little bit about that.
So I give you them. So what happens is when I'm in Houston, you know, first I get the mentally gifted minors test. Then the teachers in Houston reach out to me. And I find myself back in Mississippi. And when I got to Mississippi, you know, now I'm like, oh, I'm gonna be Mr. Bad Guy, right? So I'm running the halls, as we say, I would skip the last two periods of class. And I have an issue with anxiety, right? I didn't know that at the time. So I've never been one to attend class. You know, I always say I never met a class I like, right? So the moment classes became optional, I'm not going, right? And the other thing about that is, you know, I also found when I got to college that I think differently, right? And if I tried to understand things the way the professor was explaining them to me, I'd find myself more confused than anything. So it was better for me to take the book and my peers, right, and work through things on my own, right? So what ends up happening is the assistant principal catches me behind the building, and he was known as a disciplinarian, right? Big tall guy, Mr. Jones. And so I'm like, oh, I'm about to get paddled, you know, because they did that in the 70s, right? And so instead of taking me to the office and paddling me, he takes me to the band director, Mr. Cross, who's also known as a disciplinarian, right? They were the two bad guys. And I'm like, oh, no. And Mr. Cross is like, dude, you're going to be a tuba player. Sit down and play this tuba. Now, what was amazing about that is that led to me being involved in extracurricular activities. And extracurricular activities were as much responsible for saving me as anything else. So I started going to these competitions and winning, right? I'm all state and I'm all this. And so a thing that is difficult to understand is, you know, at this point, I've been to over 40 countries. And what I see now is every country has identity hierarchies, right? And they have many orthogonal axes, right? Race, sex, age, income, right? All these different, what do we call it? Degrees of freedom. But it works out pretty much the same in every country when you're at the top and the bottom. How the bottom sees the top and how the top sees the bottom, right? So when you're living in that segregated community, you know, when you look at others, so in the, back then I used the phrase white people, right? Because you know, when you're in rural Mississippi, only two types of people exist in the world, black people and white people, right? And you have this idea of like, oh man, they got everything figured out. They are just like, whoa. And then you go into competition, it's like, wow, I just beat all of them. What does this say about me? Wow. And so then these professors from the University of Southern Mississippi showed up. And they were like, oh, there is this thing that you guys should do. It's called science fairs. So you remember, I had taught myself, had been teaching myself relativity. Well, the year before, my girlfriend got a little Radio Shack TRS-80 computer.
Oh, yeah. I remember those.
Yeah. And so in Mississippi, we didn't date. We did what's called courting. And the way courting works is, I say courting for you guys to understand it, but the correct pronunciation is courting, right? It's like chitterlings versus chitlins. So thank you. By the way, last New Year's Eve, I cooked chitlins for the first time in my life. I didn't realize it was going to take me like 3 hours of cleaning them. But anyway, and so you also know, I grew up eating squirrels and possums and raccoons and, you know, everything in the, you don't know what you're missing. Everything in that forest in Mississippi, we ate it, right? Hunting, farming, and fishing. So I forgot the story I was telling. Which one was it?
Science fair.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So when you're courting, what happens is you go to your girlfriend's house on Sunday, you sit on opposite ends of the couch, yep. The family watches you, then you go home after 3 or 4 hours, right? So I'm like, why am I sitting on this couch with you? You got that new computer thing over there. I'm going to go learn to computer. I use it as a verb, right? I'm going to learn to computer. And it had a little book that taught you the basic programming language. So I taught myself, you know, do for loops and things like that, right? And so when these professors come around and say, you guys should participate in the science fair, I'm like, oh, I know what I'll do. I'll program all of relativity. Not realizing. You know, yeah. And so I ended up winning first place in the Mississippi State Science Fair in physics in 1985, right? And they were like, dude, you should become a physicist. And I had no idea what that meant. And so I had already, at that time, I was already an enlistee in the United States Navy as soon as I turned 17. So what happened is when I was in the 10th grade, we were all brought into the cafeteria and we were given the Armed Services Vocational Aptitude Battery Exam. A few weeks later, I get called to the principal office, which was a common thing. You guys can already tell I have a behavioral problem. But now I am a middle-aged adult, so it, you know, it doesn't really impact, but imagine me at 15. So, you know, I was always getting called to the principal's office. As a matter of fact, there was a ritual at the end of every year where my first 3 years in high school, where the teacher would bring me up, you know, every class, there was an award for the top performing student. So the teacher would call me in front of the class at the end of the year. I just want to let you know, you were the top performing student, but you're not going to get the award because, you know, there are these things that you got called demerits, behavioral demerits, right? You know, if you had over 7, you know, so I was always getting sent to the principal's office, right, for being disruptive. Like, what I would do is I'd get my school books and just devour them in the first 2 weeks. And after that, I'm telling jokes, giving people the wrong answer. You know, one of my favorite jokes, you know, there's a lot of, I was kind of like a pyromaniac kid, and so I would cut open shotgun shells, and I would put the gunpowder in a rolling paper, put a little parsley at each end, go to school and tell a guy, fire it up. Do not do this at home. It was hilarious, you know, I was a practical joker, you know, and so my mom would always warn me, boy, somebody's gonna beat you up, but no one ever did. I wasn't able to receive any of these academic awards until I got to the end. But my Navy recruiter, when he met me, he started saying things to me that no one had ever said to me before. He was like, you know, I can tell you're a guy of high character. Really? You know? And he said, you know what, man, I haven't met anyone like you. I think I'm gonna be able to get you into the Naval Academy. But he had not gone through the process himself, and so we were too late. And so he's like, I'm gonna get you in a nuclear program. And he drives me up to Jackson, Mississippi. I take the test, I pass it with flying colors. Now I'm gonna be an enlisted nuclear guy. And then he's like, oh, I found this program where they take people from parts of America, rural America, that didn't have a good education, and it's enlisted people who are identified as being officer candidates. It was called BOOST, which was an acronym that stands for Broadened Opportunity for Officer Selection and Training. And so I ended up going into the program directly out of boot camp, and it was there that I was, you know, the first time I had medical insurance, that I was diagnosed with this horrible skin condition I had for the first time, atopic dermatitis. And when the doctor diagnosed me, he said, oh, it's a good thing they didn't find this out in boot camp because you're not allowed in the Navy with this. So I knew at that point I was gonna get kicked out. Right? But luckily for me, this program, the way it was designed, was it was a hardcore military component run by the Marine Corps, hoorah, and the other side of it was a hardcore academic program. And there were two math classes. Let me tell you about my school in Mississippi. You guys know where Mississippi ranks in education among the 50 states? Somewhere like in the high 80s, right? So in the early 2000s, Mississippi evaluated all of its schools. And every school was given a rating from 1 to 5. And only 4 schools in the state got the absolutely worst rating of 5. 2 of them were my middle school and high school. So I was grossly undereducated, and math was worse. So when I took the ACT test, it was always the bottom, you know, math would be like a 13, whereas everything else is like high 20s, right? So when I got to this Navy program, the idea of it was to shore up your academics and then send you to college for 4 years, then you had to come back and be an officer for 5 or 6 years, right? And so there were 2 math classes, the regular math class and a remedial math class. Guess which one I was in? You guys don't think very highly of me, do you? But you're right. I was in a remedial class. And due to the magic of social media, we actually have a Boost 8586 Facebook group, and they think it's hilarious that they were in the regular math class and the astrophysicist was in the remedial class. But in that remedial class, we were taken from arithmetic through calculus in 1 year. And I had never heard the word calculus in my life before getting there, or trigonometry, had no idea. And I got kicked out for atopic dermatitis just as we ended algebra and were about to begin trigonometry. And that's what allowed me to succeed in college. After that, you know, so I took the ACT test and the SAT in the Navy, right? Because you were preparing for college. So at that point now, I'm in the 30s in the ACT test and high scores on the SAT test. But I get out of college, I get out of the Navy, and I'm aimless. I don't have a plan. I didn't see college. You know, I knew I was supposed to say I'm going to college, but I had no idea what that really meant, right? And so some of my buddies who were a year ahead of me in high school, they came home, you know, and we went out to the club together, and they talked me into going to college. So here's the thing, though. I didn't realize I was supposed to apply first.
So you just go?
I just showed up at Tougaloo, right? Me and my buddy Steve Gavin and this other guy, Benny Windham Smooth. Like, oh, you going to Tougaloo? I'm going to Tougaloo. Let's ride up together, right? And then I get there, and they're like, dude, who are you, right? But, you know, they know how to deal with students like me, right? And they got me in, and, you know, I would like to say the rest is history, but it's not. You know, it was another level of that I had not seen before. And, you know, I just got my butt kicked academically. And the other thing is that, you know, I started developing, you know, just like I said, my dad had a business. Well, from the age of 14, I had my own business. And when I got to college, you know, they got cameras in the room. What's the statute of limitations? Let me see what. Yeah. So what happens is, when I get out of the Navy, I visit my father, and he has a talk with me about the danger of the streets and how I'm not the guy for the streets, right? I'm a nerd, you know? And he's like, anything you want to do, you come to my house. Don't you be out there in the streets. And so when I get to when I get to college, I have a roommate, a guy I knew from home. He was one of these folks from up south. You guys heard that phrase? So when all the manufacturing jobs were up in Detroit and Chicago, a lot of people, especially African Americans, moved from the deep south up there, right? And then what happens? They have kids, their kids start getting in troubles with the gangs, they send them down to grandma in Mississippi, right? And those kids were terrorizing us. And so this guy was one of those kids. And so his dad had his own business in Chicago. And one of his customers was Natalie Cole, the singer, by the way. And so my father had his business. So when I told him, you know, he was a guy who wanted to be Scarface, right? I just wanted to eat and live indoors. And he was like, let's go visit your dad. So we started doing that, making runs down to New Orleans and back up to Jackson, Mississippi. And unfortunately, we started doing this in late 1986. And this was the beginning of, you know, in the South, the crack cocaine epidemic. And every time we'd visit my father to make these pickups, you know, there would be a guy in the kitchen with a bowl and this mound of powder and, you know, a little chemistry set going on. And no one realized what a horrible demon that was. No one knew yet. And so I'd be sitting there with my brother, my father, like, hey, you want to try it? It's the best thing there is. And I'm like, no, I'll pass. And I did that for a year and a half until I didn't. And what ends up happening is eventually I drop out of college and I decide I'm tired of this life. I'd rather live. And so I got a job. The job I could get was as a janitor at the nearby hotel, the Ramada Renaissance. And I was so broke at this time. I was making $4 an hour. And if I got 30 hours in a week, that was a great week, right? And so I basically just had enough money to pay for my apartment in the hood in Jackson, Mississippi, and put gas in my car. And the way I would feed myself is that when people would order room service at the hotel and they'd put their tray outside their door, I'd walk through the halls and eat their leftovers, right? And the crazy thing is, and I get chills just saying this, in 2015, Tougaloo College brought me back to honor me to be the presidential lecturer, and they put me up in the presidential suite of the same hotel in which I was a janitor. And the crazy thing is, I walk in the door, and the guy behind the desk and I recognize each other immediately. He was the only person still working there from 1988. And, you know, we caught up, he told me everything, but talk about, you know, I would go up there, I'm sorry, it's kind of...
No, it's amazing.
Yeah.
So thanks for sharing this. So tell us, how do you follow the path from college to grad school? How do you become interested in your field of research?
Yeah.
Made you converge there?
You know, it's almost like it was meant to be, because these people would just show up, right? So that guy, Lorenzo Dunbar, I told you about, right? He's the guy who would keep me on track. So my first two summers, I was homeless, okay? And I had this thing called toxic masculinity. So my mom literally lived in a trailer in the woods. And I'm like, I am not going home to be a burden on my family. All right, I'm gonna make it on my own. And so I was couch surfing homeless, not living in the streets homeless, right? And I ended up staying with this totally insane guy who I didn't know was insane. You know, when you have a friend, you know, I know you, you're Fernando, and then we move in together and I realize that you're completely insane, right? Like, I kid you not, me and this guy, we'd sit in the, on days I didn't work, we'd sit in the living room watching TV all day, and he'd go away, you know, to the bathroom or something, to his room for a couple hours, come back in his Air Force uniform, and sit down next to me and tell me about his day. Oh yeah, I visited my girlfriend, I went to the base, and I'm like, at first I was like, ha 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 ha, and I realized he's serious, right? And then, you know, I find a guy standing over me at night, you know, one time with a shotgun, and I'm just like, okay, I'm out of here. But the second summer, I'm like, okay, I'm not gonna do that again. So, Tougaloo did not have summer schools. They did have an upward bound program, and they all went into the female freshman dorm. But the other dorms were unoccupied. And if maintenance was working in a dorm, they turned the air conditioner on in that dorm. So that summer, they were working in a female dorm. And so I knew if they're working in that section, I could break into the dorm and sleep in this section, okay? And so my classmate, Lorenzen, was working in the admissions office. So he comes and wakes me up right in the beginning of the summer. Hey, University of Georgia called for you. They said they need your social security number so your check could be ready when you get there. I had no idea what he was talking about, but I know what a check is. So I went to the admissions office, called him back, and it turns out that what had happened is they had received an NSF Research Experiences for Undergraduates grant, and they got it so late in the year that they didn't have time to recruit. And so they contacted professors they knew and asked if they could recommend anyone. And my chemistry professor, Richard McGinnis, recommended me. And so I figured if anybody knew what this was about, it was Professor McGinnis. So I go and find him in Kinchlow Hall, and he goes, oh, they accepted you. And I say to him, I say, well, you know what, Professor McGinnis, doesn't matter. I don't have a car. I don't have any money to get there. Thank you, but, you know, I can't do it. He ends up buying me a Greyhound ticket to get to Athens, Georgia, out of his own pocket, right? So I get to Athens, Georgia, and I'm working for a guy named Michael Duncan in physical chemistry. And he takes me into his lab, and this is when, you know, a laser filled the whole lab. thing. He worked in small molecular clusters. They would hit a target with some a laser, you know, ablate a few molecules. They do what's called supersonic jet expansion to cool it to near zero. So van der Waals forces create these small molecular clusters, they're called, okay? And so my project for the summer was study the literature, then use this theoretical program to see if it actually reproduces the experimental results, right? And they're looking at bond lengths and geometries. But he takes me and he tells me what my job is. Then the moment, the life-changing moment occurs. This is day one. He's like, you know, researchers keep all these odd hours. So you're gonna need keys. Here's a key to the building, the key to the lab, and the key to my office. Dude. When you are the bad guy, the guy who's always accused, something goes missing, he did it, right? Now, don't get me wrong. I was living in an all-black world, you know, and so, you know, at work and stuff like that. So at work, you know, is when you were in a integrated world, right? But, you know, you're always under suspicion. And this dude just gave me the keys to the building. I was like, wow, this is unbelievable. And so then I do my work, and at the end of the summer, they're like, Hakeem, man, you're good at this research thing. You should become a researcher. And I was like, wait a minute. You don't prejudge me. And then when you do judge me, it's on the merits? Am I in the Twilight Zone? Right? And so I left that summer thinking, this is the career for me, research. And then I went to Tougaloo, got back involved in the drug business, and dropped out and became a janitor. Right? But at the end of that janitor thing, a bellhop got fired, and I saw that as my big break, because a bellhop could get $100 in tips in a day. Now, understand my community and how we think. When I was at my high school, there was an old man who had been the maintenance guy forever. He retired, and a guy who had graduated a couple of years earlier gets the maintenance job. You know, you're the custodian at the high school. How do we describe that guy in our community? Do you know what the phrase? It's a four-word phrase we would always say about him. He got it made, right? You know, where I come from, if you go home and they're like, yo, man, Jerry got a job at Walmart. What's your response to that? Great, right? Every job's a good job, you know? So, you know, even my janitor job was a good job. So, but being a bellhop, oh, dude, I get to wear a suit and a tie and be at the front door and get tips. Oh, that's like becoming president of the United States of America, as far as I'm concerned, right? But they decided I wasn't front door material, right? And I'll tell you what's really interesting. So what happened is the manager of the hotel was this really debonair, suave, well put together gentleman about 6'6" named Fortuné Jobert from New Orleans. And so when I chatted with when I chatted with the women in housekeeping, they were like, oh, you know, he's from New Orleans too. Of course, with a name like Fortuné Jobert. And they were like, oh, you know, he was in the Navy too. Oh, he plays the tuba too. So eventually, we chatted, all right? So when I didn't get the job, he called me into his office and he said, hey man, you know, I really wanted to give you the position, but Miss Jolly, who was the head of housekeeping, so all of housekeeping was black except for two people, the head housekeeping lady, Miss Jolly, and the assistant housekeeping lady. And Miss Jolly addressed everybody as girl and boy, all right? And so the way things work in Mississippi, you know, it's not like some hierarchy, right? They, you know, they have their debates, the maids and Miss Jolly talk trash to each other. But what I didn't understand as a young person was the following. When they would have these factual debates, they called in the smart college boy to, what's the truth, Hakeem? Now, when your boss and your colleague are having a debate and they bring you in to resolve the debate and the boss is wrong, what do you say? Oops, sorry. Well, you don't say you're wrong, boss, which is what I did. I told the truth. And so Ms. Jolly didn't appreciate that. So Mr. Jobert told me, he was like, you know, Ms. Jolly gave you a bad recommendation, so I couldn't do it. A second thing she did is Tougaloo was having a reception-like event like this in this ballroom in a hotel, and I come in a rare weekend morning, because I normally work that night, and she's like, you know what? There's wax buildup around the baseboards in this room. Take this brush, which looked like a toothbrush, and go there and scrub those, you know, the wax around those baseboards. And I walk into that room and there's the Tougaloo professors and everybody. And I'm in my janitor outfit. And I go about my job, embarrassed as heck, right? Mr. Joubert, in his tall, slim amazingness, walks over to me down there and gets on one knee next to me. And he says, I imagine how this must make you feel. And then he says, you know, you'd be surprised to know that I started out just like this. And if it wasn't for experiences like this, I may have never grown up to be a gentleman. And I never heard the word gentleman used in that way before. You know, I'd heard ladies and gentlemen, but not a thing to aspire to, right? And that meant so much to me. And then when Christmas came, he gave bonuses to two people in the hotel, and it was myself and the maintenance guy, right? And so, you know, and so I decide, okay, I can't go from janitor to bellhop. I better go back to college. So I re-enroll at Tougaloo, and just as soon as I re-enroll, these three graduate students from MIT show up. And of course, I'm up in the dorm room skipping class. Lorenzen comes and gets me and takes me down there. And we met with them in the library, and they told us, they said, listen, we just started this new conference we call the National Conference of Black Physics Students. And we would like to bring you all to MIT and tell you about a career as a physicist. Now, I was taking my first physics class, and I discovered that all I had to do is show up for the exams and I get 100. Because I had done so much physics for fun as a kid, it was already there. And the expectations were so low, right, that I could exceed them. So I become a physics major, and it's through those, through that conference that I learned what it is. I learned that graduate school is a thing. I learned that the GRE is a thing. I learned strategies of how to get in graduate school from my position, from other people who had gotten in graduate school from my position. And then miracle upon miracle, when I applied to graduate schools, I applied to 10. Everywhere where I knew someone, because either I had done summer research there or I'd met them at that conference, I was admitted. Everywhere where I did not know someone, I was rejected, with but one exception, LSU, who accepted me, right? So, you know, it was like these magical people just showed up and said, do this. And I followed what they suggested, and it turned into sitting down here having a conversation with Fernando.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. That's wonderful. Let me switch gears a little bit. I mean, I'd be interested, and I'm sure the audience as well. You know, you could probably argue that the state of science in general around the world, but actually probably more so in the U.S., has been increasingly scrutinized, challenged, attacked, whatever word you want to choose. I'd be interested in your perspective, having lived through, science, how you've lived it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, what do you think it's ahead of us? And how do you see yourself in that role? I mean, you're now a leader, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah,
you're right, a leader right, now. Right, so right. how do you see your role in taking that on?
You know what? I see a different current reality. What I see is that science has never been more popular, right? I see there's armies of scientists in every country around the world, right? So the thing is, though, there are a lot of loud voices. And so, you know, it's always there, and it's not really so much anti-science, I believe, as it is a counterculture thing, right? It's like, when someone says, the earth is flat and all this kind of stuff, what they're saying is, forget you nerds, you know, still the nerds versus the jocks kind of thing in society. And, you know, here, I'm the authority. I'm gonna tell you the way the world is. And people are like, no, you ain't. You ain't telling me nothing. I'm gonna say the opposite just because, right? I think that's at least half of the phenomenon. And long before we had the current world, you know, I would go back home to Mississippi and, you know, my friends would be like, man don't know everything. You know, man can't know everything. You know what? Science don't know nothing. I had a buddy, the doctor gave him 2.5 seconds to live. That was 88 years ago. He's still kicking, right? And so what I attempt to do is I'll tell people, I'll say, hey, well, you know what? Science ain't science. And they're like, what do you mean? I was like, well, you know, there are different branches of science. There's the formal sciences, which are exact, and predictions are exact, mathematics, logic, some computer science. Then there are the natural sciences, physical sciences like physics, chemistry, space sciences. Then there's the life sciences, and then the social sciences. And as you go, the error bars on a prediction get bigger and bigger and bigger. So if I make a prediction in physics, my error bar, you know, I can make a prediction of many different, to many decimal places with a tiny error bar. But what is the error bar when a doctor makes a prognosis? I maintain that it's plus or minus a lifetime, right? Because you could die that very moment, or you could spontaneously heal, right? So the predictive power of medicine can't be compared to the predictive power of physics. So I see everything as sort of like a learning and teaching opportunity, if they're open to that. Otherwise, I'd be like, you know, like in Mississippi, I remember my mom pulled me to the side when I was like 14 or 15, because, you know, they gave me the identity, the professor. So I was gonna play the role. So what do you do when you're the smart kid? You correct people's grammar. That lasted about a week. And my mom, because, you know, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the phrase ghetto fabulous, but, you know, there's a grammar component to it, right? You know, you speak properly, but with just improper grammar. We is gonna go to the, you know what I'm saying? That's personal experience laughing. And so my mom was like, look, that ain't cool, right? That's not cool. And so, and by the way, I say things like ain't on purpose, just so you know, because there's a lot of gatekeepers in this world, right? There's a lot of prejudging of people. So when someone like me talks like where people like me talk, they're like, oh, okay, that doesn't mean you're an idiot or you're disqualified, right? That idiot did it, right? So what was the question again?
No, we were talking about you were presenting your perspective.
Oh, yeah. So, you know, correcting people. So here's how it works. You know, there's a certain respect type thing that goes. So, you know, you learn. Like, I'll give you an example. I was sitting on the porch with some old folks, shelling peas, purple hull peas, and one of them, they were talking about tornadoes. And one of them goes, I hear a tornado is like a big ball of fire that just comes through. Do I say, well, actually, it's an atmosphere? No. You go, yes, ma'am. Right? And so sometimes it's time to be like, yes, sir, yes, ma'am, and leave it at that, right? You know, it's reading the room, reading the situation, you know? And definitely never, you know, quite often people will come up to me and they'll say, oh, you know, if I talk about cosmology, the origin and evolution of the universe, you said science says, but the Bible says, or the Quran says, and I'll say quickly, I'll go, first off, science don't say nothing. Science doesn't say, science asks. Universe, what are you? Tell me. And then the universe tells you what it is. I don't present it on the universe. Then I say to them, I was like, listen, especially if you're under 18, I'm not gonna talk to you about your faith, right? If you wanna learn science and how that works, I'll talk to you about that. Now, if you're an adult, I might add this. If you find that, you know, my definition of science is two things. It is a process for discovering truth in a certain way, but it's also a report on what has been observed to be true with the error bars, right? And so I say that if you find that your faith belief is in conflict with what we have observed to be true, then you now have a decision to make on your own. It doesn't necessarily mean you have to abandon your faith, but you have to come to that resolution as an individual. That's not for me to tell you.
Yeah, that's a very mature way of approaching it, yeah. Tell us a little bit about your plans for working with students, with faculty, with colleagues at Mason.
Yeah. So I plan to take over the world. I don't know. So I'm first we're gonna start the presidency, and then we're gonna work our way up from there. So y'all think I'm joking? I've had this plan since I was 12. So you know, I find that. So first thing I did is when I forgot what was that day where everybody was out on the plaza called? Yeah, to get connected fair. So I went around and I connected with several students and student groups, you know, that I recognized and said, hey, I'm in town, here's my contact information, let's get together. And so, you know, at my previous university, right, I ran a major, the interdisciplinary sciences major, which was a, you know, save me major for many students, because what would happen is, if students were having a tough time after 2 or 3 years and they needed to change majors, interdisciplinary sciences was the one major where no matter what courses you've taken before, they still count towards your major, right? So you don't lose years and things like that. But then we put them into a You know, I have what I've seen is a lot of students that don't get traction, it's not because they're not academically gifted or working hard. It's a social dynamic that's taking place. They feel isolated. And so, you know, research groups, when you bring them in and create a family environment, create a support system, they can blossom and take over. So my plan is to create communities and families and support and be there where I'm needed. Education changed my life. So when my sister's oldest daughter, who graduated high school without getting pregnant, both the daughters, yes, and my daughter, when she was a sophomore in high school, I started encouraging her to attend college, and she was like, no. And I was like, why not? She's like, I don't like school. And I'm like, I'm impersonator. I don't like school. And I'm like, well, you know what the alternative is, right? You got to get a job. She's like, well, I like working. And so, you know, eventually I gave up, and, you know, I knew her mind was set. And so she graduates, she gets the job she can get in our community, which is working at Sanderson Farms, which is a chicken plant in Ellisville. 3 years later, she announces to me, I'm going to college. And I was home for the holidays, and there was another family visiting, and they were talking, trying to encourage their young family member to go to college, and they were resisting. So I decided that I was gonna tease Monique, take the opportunity. And I said, well, you know what? Get him a job at the chicken plant. That chicken plant got Monique to go to college. And Monique goes, that ain't why I'm going. And I was like, really, why? And she goes, you. I see your life, that's what I want. Well, Monique now has a master's degree in education and just passed her exam, and she's now an assistant principal in Katy, Texas. And I say that because that's what you do when you're a patron of the observatory, right? The students that are coming to us are people that are just like I was, right? And they need that support. And so the people that showed up for me didn't realize what they were creating, right? And in the same way, you're doing the exact same thing. When you make your contributions to the university, to the students, you're creating the new Hakeems, the new Peters, and you're changing entire communities. That's the amazing thing about it. It's super powerful. So thank you. I don't know who you are, but thank you. Thank you.